Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We are at the crossroads, the buried crossroads. And there are many cool items here. This is the lair of the changing god, or was once the lair of the changing god. Sleek and streamlined, this machine hums with energy. You're fairly certain that it came to life just as you entered the chamber. So last episode we snuck our way through the lair of the Stika, which I learned is pronounced not Stitcha, but Stika, just as Calistege is actually pronounced Calistege. So we snuck through them, didn't kill a single one, didn't get attacked by a single one, didn't have to destroy their eggs, so that's a good thing. I still want to, you know, bargain with them, try to get them to leave the city, find a good solution for everybody. Of course, the fact that I was in amongst their lair, they may remember, because I was spotted several times. But maybe the fact that I walked through their lair and didn't hurt anybody and didn't destroy their eggs will, you know, be like, okay, you don't mean to harm us. Maybe. I don't know how these things think. They're, you know, kind of foreign to us. The sorrow looms from this skillfully created mural. You can almost feel its clammy tendrils wrapping around your heart. Its inhuman victims twist and writhe, pleading for an impossible mercy. Some of the glowing bands on this machine have gone dark. It seems to be dying. Okay, so we can interact with many things, such as this. And there's loot. We can interact with that. We can interact with this.
Why not?
Let's find it. Let's get this loot first. Cause I'm all about that loot. About that loot. Oh my, there's a lot of stuff. 54 shins. We've got a quest item, the Tome of Singing Thorns. A healing sword. An encephalic rush, which heals 3 points of intellect. We've seen that before. And a sting charge. Oh, I just bought that. I just literally bought that for Calistege. Well, now we can sell this one, I guess.
I'll remember that.
We'll take that all. Now, this is the book that they were looking for, then. These people. Felinda, a bookseller and circus miner, has accused me of borrowing a very rare book and never returning it. I have no memory of such a thing, so it seems likely that the changing god was the real culprit. Perhaps when he was wearing the body that is now mine. It seemed important to Felinda that I find and return the book. I found the missing book in the Changing God's Sanctuary. It's called the Tome of Singing Thorns, though it doesn't appear to be an ordinary book. Felinda should still be at her stall in the Circus Minor when I'm ready to return the book. Okay, cool. But I do want to look at this thing. Because I love books. Okay, it's a quest item. The pages of this ancient heavy book rustle as if waiting to be turned. A cast-off tattoo is inscribed onto the title page. Someone has attached a much newer tag to the binding which reads, Exclusive Property of Felinda and Steristi, Booksellers. Now if I use the item, is that a bad thing? I'm sure I'm going to get blue tide, probably silver. I do want to look at it though, because I love books, especially old books, tomes. You flip open the cover of the Tome of Singing Thorns. On the title page is a cast-off's tattoo divided into 5 curving triangular shapes, the color of each tide, with a small inscription beneath. You try turning to the next page, but can't. It's as if the pages are a solid block of paper. You lay your hand on the title page's rough, somewhat metallic surface, and the sharp triangular shapes spring up around your fingers with a vibrating hum. The possibility of losing your fingers to this book was a danger Felinda somehow neglected to mention. Read the inscription. It is written in a firm, sharp hand that nearly carved the letters through the page. Symptoms: cyanosis, hemophilia, spontaneous bruising, jaundice, argyria. See her as she was. You do not deserve to forget what you lost. If I had to choose, touch the gold thorn. You caress the golden thorn. A warm note rises from within it, making your fingers tingle. After a moment, the music fades abruptly. Really? Cyanosis. He's blue. Cyan. Hemophilia. Loving blood? Being excited by blood? In a certain way? Blue, red, spontaneous bruising? Purple or violet? Jaundice is like green? Or giant? Okay, I'm thinking these are medical symptoms which correspond to colors. Blue. Hemo is blood. Red. Spontaneous bruising would think violet, like purple, right? Jaundice, I would think green, but... And I don't even know what Argyra is, but we don't have green. We have gold. And silver. Maybe Argyria is silver? So wait. And I don't know what this means. See her as she was. You do not deserve to forget what you lost. That's a riddle that will probably make sense in time, but... right now. Jaundice? Goldish? Okay, so blue. You experimentally run your finger along the back of the blue thorn. The moment raises a cool, complex note from the curved surface. Red. You carefully pluck the crimson thorn like a stringed instrument. A note rises from the vibrating razor edge like blood. It hangs in the air, trembling. Violet? Oh wait, indigo. We don't have violet, we have indigo. Indigo. You tap this dense thorn, coaxing a multitude of tiny chime-like sounds from the metal. As you listen, they coalesce into a single firm note. It hangs in the air, strong and deep. Gold? You caress the golden thorn. The note rises into the air. Silver. You prod the silver thorn, producing a high, pure note. It hangs in the air, growing ever louder. Really, it looks like I did it. Okay. The notes surrounding you scatter into silence as if swept aside by an impatient hand. The book blurs open, flipping from page to page faster than you can read. But still you catch glimpses. Neat tables of strange creatures and their title affinities. Dwindling question marks on each page as the author understood more and more. And through it all, you feel the book reading you. Touching parts of your mind, erasing uncertainties, and reopening portions that have long been closed. I permanently gain 1 intellect. Nice. Maximum intellect pool is now 13. That's awesome. The book closes with a firm, satisfying thud. I guess I got it right. Now, I could mess with it some more, but I'm afraid if I get it wrong, because I was going to trade out gold and silver... Afraid if I get it wrong that I'll lose something. So let's leave it there. And I picked up more things, didn't I? A healing sword and a sting charger, which we will sell. 8 physical damage, plus 4 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 8. On critical hits, heals 4 points of health on the wielder. Sweet. The keen blade of this sword is pitted and poorly maintained. If not for the pristine synth hilt, it would be better suited for the scrap pile. When you grasp the hilt and twist, a viscous green fluid oozes out and slowly creeps around your hands. The fluid is cool and soothing to the touch, and the scent of it fills you with a heady sensation. Whenever a foe is cut by the blade, their blood seems to mingle with the liquid and flow down into your hands, invigorating you. That's cool. Their blood mingling with the viscous fluid. I like that. It's disgusting, yet, you know, you help heal me. So a mystical lore tells, old stories tell of a sword passed from warlord to warlord. Owners survived impossible battles without a scratch and won great renown. In their seeming invincibility, they became brash, overconfident, even bloodthirsty, until inevitably they met a violent end and had the sword pried from their hands, green overcome by red. That's pretty expensive, too. Let's see. Does he want it? Should he have it? We have a great sword. He has an axe. Wait. Can I see? I can't compare here. 8 physical damage. Oh yeah, give it to Tybear. Nice. Because he's using a sword now. Medium? Medium. 3 physical damage. This does 8 physical damage. Yeah! You're going to be kicking butt, buddy. I'll give that to myself. I don't know what he's saying. He's like... Alright, so we got that. And also give her this. So when we return to the vendor, I have a few things to sell. I'm going to keep the oddities, but I'll sell this, and this, and this. And that's it. I'll keep the rest. I might sell the boots, I don't know. Can't even consider wearing them. Yeah, see why I would keep it. Probably sell the boots too. Alright. Cool. Let's interact with this thing.
Yes.
This device looks like it was once part of some larger device, or a network of devices, embedded in the rock beneath the city. Thick cables disappear into holes in the wall. The machine gives off a low hum just at the edge of your hearing. Try to figure out how the machine works. I have machinery lore. Touching the etched surface reveals a display interface, but it seems unresponsive to your gestures and commands. The display does show a vast network of other devices it must be connected to. If you're reading it correctly, there's a vast array of machines and engines operating somewhere underneath the city. This interface might control them. Try to use it. You poke it, swipe it, yell at it, speak gently to it, but the interface is completely unresponsive to your commands. No matter what you try, the interface remains unresponsive. Okay. That's it for that, then. We also got that device. And this is examine. What is this? Mirrors. A staggering array of mirrors and lenses encircle you. Cables run from their backs to various machines scattered throughout the room. Your hands ache at the sight of this sanctuary, this workshop. Your predecessor spent many hours here, and your body remembers. Behind the display, you hear a hinge creak. You know what? Before I mess with this very important thing, let me look at this.
Yes, now.
Oh, wow. This is important, too. Never mind. As you approach the machine, Calistage rushes to examine it more closely. This device. Your sire used it to maintain access to the datasphere. I must know how. Did he leave notes nearby? Try to remember where the notes might be. You feel an itching at the base of your skull. Oh, by the way, success. And we got a book? Suddenly, your right hand starts moving of its own volition, jabbing down to touch the nearby floor in a frenzied but purposeful series of movements. Next to your feet, a stone compartment slides open. It reveals a leather-bound journal within. Callistes approaches with reverence. May I? She asks, holding out her hands for the book. I'm gonna get blue or silver for this. I'm gonna look at it first. I'm gonna let you look at it, but it's a book. I wanna look at it. It belonged to my sire. I'd like to look at it first. Blue, moderate, silver, tiny, see? I see. She considers you, folding her hands demurely in front of her. Is it because you don't trust me with the knowledge it contains? No, don't answer. I will find out what it contains eventually. She returns to looking at the Numenera without a backward glance. I'm just going to look at it first. But don't think I will forget. I want to look at it first. Come on, man.
Go.
Data flickers and flashes around this machine too quickly for you to make any sense of it. All right, let me look at the book. A study in datasphere analysis. This leather-bound journal is filled with various diagrams, notes, and observations of the machines you found near the engines buried beneath Sega's cliffs. The handwriting is your creator's, and it chronicles his analysis of the datasphere, the net of information that surrounds and permeates the world's air. Some people have drawn power from the world, and others have found a way to transmit knowledge in the blink of an eye. It seems that these machines may have been intended to transmit consciousness itself, or at least to take a rudimentary first step in that direction. The exact steps are unclear, though someone with an extensive background in consciousness transfer or machine intelligences might be able to recreate his work. Again, could be the guy in the, what do you call it? The Order of Truth. I don't suppose I have an option to give it to her. Let me just look at this. Every time I hit this thing, the music starts up again. What's that? Is that part of the rungs? Oh, it just collapsed, yeah. Investigate the machine. Something about the device suggests datasphere to you, but no. The memory is gone. You run your hands across the machine, try to lift it, and interact with it in other ways, but nothing seems to work. It's a mystery to you. You learn nothing new about the machine. Alright, let's look at this thing. And I'll see if I can talk to her and give her the book. You step back into the semicircle of mirrors, sensing the pressure of invisible eyes on you. Study the lenses and mirrors. The mirrors twitch as you gaze from surface to surface. Eventually you realize why. They are attuned to your mind. You can move each one as effortlessly as your own hand. Every surface shows something else besides your reflection. A sliver of glass highlights a red cord around your throat. A small oval mirror lingers on a pulsing blue star beneath your forehead. The mirrors to either side of the large central mirror periodically flash purple. The tides. So do we know the tides of the changing god? Or at least what they were at that time? We've got... Let me just write it down in case we need this. I mean, it'll probably be, if it's important, it'll be in the journal anyway. But just in case. So, we've got red, which is like small, right? Sliver of glass. Or tiny, right? Tiny is a sliver of glass. And then small is blue. The mirrors to either side of the large central tree. I don't know if that's large or just something, I don't know, medium. Because it's either one. But together they could be large. Purple or violet. The tiny lenses above it all crane their necks to study you. One of them appears to be shivering. You sense that the tiny lenses are moving with purpose, and hold still. They carefully swivel to focus on your arms, and you see something odd. The you in the audience of lenses is bigger, stronger. You feel a painful twinge in the crook of your arm, and one of the lenses goes cloudy gray. Huh. Well, we've got more puzzles. Examine the small oval mirror. Before I move anything, I'm just gonna examine things. The pulsing blue star beneath your forehead expands as you watch. Oddly enough, it feels like it belongs there, like it was waiting to be discovered. Motion draws your attention to the other two mirrors. In them, you see a very different reflection of yourself. Pale clouds of blue light surround your hands. Feathery tendrils trail from every fingertip, flicking at the air. You raise your hand. Your reflection does as well. And suddenly your hand burns with the ache of the radiant object within it. I don't want to pluck out the object. Look at your hands first. The skin is glowing. Tiny needle-like tendrils emerge from the tips of each finger. Tiny tools for delicate work. Pluck out the object. We've got a bronze sphere. We've got a bronze sphere, guys. That's how you get a bronze sphere. Planescape Torment. Bronze sphere. You press your fingertips against your forehead and feel the needle-like tendrils close around the round object inside your head. My head? Carefully you pull it out. The rising agony melts away and the glow slowly fades from your hands, revealing a bronze sphere in your palm, growing more substantial with every passing second. That was Farad, who usually has the bronze sphere. Study the lenses and mirrors again. Ooh. The larger ones respond to the lightest touch of your mind. The smaller mirrors strain, creaking to study you. Same. Look into the large central mirror. Of all of them, this mirror seems the most mundane. It shows your unaltered reflection, the crease between your far eyebrows as you concentrate, and the gaunt, staring creatures in the hallway behind you. Focus the mirrors to look on the creatures. Are they really there? The mirrors strain at your bidding, and you see the things behind you clearly. They're bony. Nude. Ooh, time to get it on. Snuffling at the air through a slit in their swollen faces. One of them wheels around, fixing you with a single hungry eye. It stumbles toward you, feet scraping across the stone. The rest stagger after it, slurping and grasping. The Abykoses. Oh, we heard about them. Pan-dimensional entities that feed on power sources and ancient devices. They won't attack you so long as you give them something to eat. What do they eat? Power sources. I don't want to... Can they eat these power sources? I mean, I can't do anything with them. Stay back. I have no food for you here. Blue tide. The entities do not respond to your warning. Snuffling and choking, they stagger at you, claws outstretched. Ay-yay. There's a bunch. What's it doing? It's phasing itself. Probably makes it harder to hit. Ow. Alright, Eretus. Enemies in immediate cone. Well, we'd only hit one. So we might as well just attack. Nice. I can't attack again. So I'm gonna end my turn. Sucker punch.
Down you go.
Cool, I was hoping that would work. He's phasing. What happens? Can they fully phase? And that could give us trans-dimensional damage too, which I'm not sure what that would do. Well, at least they're all in one place. I can do the arc next time. Well, most of them are. Oh, now they are. We're alright, we're alright. Whose turn? Castoff's turn. They're all pretty much undamaged. One enemy. I'm just gonna hit him.
Missed.
And miss.
They think they have me surrounded.
Callisthenes is so cool. All right, what can she do? We have a area effect spell or something. Transdimensional onslaught. I kind of wonder if these things would be immune to transdimensional since they are transdimensional. Now I increased something. Well, that's why I increased transdimensional onslaught. It's one enemy. You know, I'm just gonna hit because I'm not sure what that does. Nice. Too bad they can't attack again.
Look! All the odds are stacked against me!
I guess that's something he likes. Alright, what do we have? The cone. The fell swoop. If I want to get two of them, it's going to have to be these two. Barely. Cool. We're doing well.
Give a man some elbow room, will you?
Nah. Tiber is cool. Now, as much as I'd love to help me, these things are really damaged. I'd love to just take one down right now.
No hard feelings. Why not?
Full phase. Oh! How did that happen? Ah! I missed that. Did it try to run? Did I get an attack of opportunity or something? Whose turn? Cast off. We've got that thing. And this thing was right here, so. How about onslaught? Energy.
Ha! I'm barely hurting it.
Yeah, I guess energy isn't that good. Either that or I rolled badly. I'm just gonna stay right where I am. She can't attack this time. We try transdimensional onslaught.
And another one dispatched.
It did work. Okay, cool. Eretis. Let's finish
heroic
this.
Strike of heroic proportion.
Cool. Well, that takes care of that. Now, if I mess with this mirror again, is it going to happen again? Oh, Tiber can level up. Oh, and cast off.
Here.
We can only increase edge. Provides a bonus to all tasks and challenges. Well, let's help Might along then, I guess. I wonder what they're saying. I don't think it's supposed to sound like that. Singularity Spike adds +2 relativistic, ignores resistance damage to all attacks. Your weapons blur between multiple dimensions, doing damage to armor, flesh, and reality itself. Sweet. Oh, nice. I got 2 points for tier 2 abilities. Resourceful. +1 cipher, mind barrier, +1 intellect pool, and +1 armor. That's pretty neat. Energize. Confer energize. All damage dealt is converted to the chosen type. Adaptation. Gain protected. Armor bonus +2 per tier. Resistance bonus +1 per tier. Does that mean I have to take adaptation every time? Or I'll take adaptation and it remains on me and just as I go up it gets resistance. That would be worth it. Consumes action. If that levels up with you, those are the most powerful things. I'm not sure if I have to take it every time, though, that's the thing. +1 training. That's pretty cool. Lore machinery. Lore mystical. Lore natural. More lore. We got flash again. All enemies struck inside the radius. Quantum step. Teleport one ally. Could be helpful too. Targeting eye. A mechanical enhancement to your biological eye helps you focus your more esoteric attacks. Entropic field. Entropic field. None can stand before you. Oh, decisions, decisions. I don't know, guys. Crap. I kind of want this just for the +1 armor. Intellect will always help, right? I can cast more and more spells. Sorry, just really deliberating here. Protected. I'm going to take this, and I'm going to hope that it levels up automatically. Not that you'd have to take, you know, I level up to the next level, level 5 or whatever, and then I have to take adaptation again in order to get +4 armor and +1 resistance. Oh, I have 1 point remaining, so I can take another one. Flash. Teleporting. You can only teleport them to you, not anywhere you want, which is a little limited. Energized, flash, lore. ...15% on esoteric attacks. I don't... it's so hard. Flash. No, I don't even know which ones I chose. Adaptation and flash. Okay, confirm. Time here. Stat pools. Might. Yeah. Might and speed. Okay.
All right.
You step back into the semicircle of mirrors, sensing the pressure of invisible eyes on you. Watch for the purple glow on the side mirrors. As soon as you look at the mirror to your left, a torrent of radiant light flows to you, nearly tugging you off your feet. You regain your balance just in time to see the light pass into the mirror on your right. In that mirror, you see a machine aglow with the same purple light you spotted before. If you allow the light to carry you, chances are that it will take you to wherever that machine is. Okay, they'll be leaving the room, right? Determine the purpose of the tiny lenses. You mentally draw the attention of the tiny lenses, feeling the pull of their eyeless gaze on your skin. In their reflection, you see an idealized version of yourself. Stronger, smarter, faster. And in a flash, you understand. They can change you, improve you. But a few of them are glowing cloudy under the strain. You should act quickly. Direct them at your head for intelligence. Yeah. Intelligence, might, speed.
I'm ready to become even more heroic!
I was right. The constellations of tiny lenses align with your head, and you meet the gaze of your reflection. Something snaps in your mind, and suddenly you feel sharper, more alert. One by one, the lenses fade into opaque haze with only one, until only one remains as bright as a winter star. Now, I think from now on, I should increase might and speed a little bit. I just want to be really high in the intelligence pool, guys. I want to be, you know, a really awesome nano. So we permanently gain one intellect, so intellect pool max is now 14. And we got a little XP, too. Yeah, same thing. Move the silvered mirror that shows the red band around your neck. Mentally, you jostle the mirror and feel an invisible noose close around your throat and tighten. Gasping, you sink to your knees, fall to your side, and as your vision goes dark, you realize that if you've survived this death, you found a shortcut into the labyrinth. How convenient.
Huh. I can't die.
Yeah, too late for that. So we wanted to go back here to talk to the ghost lady. Spectre says, I can't say I expected you back so soon. Has anything changed since the last time I was here? He shrugs. Look around. It's your mind. What should I do now? This Matkina is our best lead. Good luck. To the ninth world. To the Daughter's Fathom. We're gonna go there next. We're gonna go to the Daughter's Fathom. Thanks so much for watching, guys. What a long episode. See you next time when we go to the Daughter's Fathom and after that, maybe, if there's time, we'll go back to the crossroads and check out that other mirror. Go through the violet mirror, whatever. See you next time, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.